Hi folks, welcome to this video on memory models. So this little video clip is going to look at the Atkinson and Shiffrin model of memory and also the Crick and Lockhart model of memory, and we're going to look at the differences between the two. But first I'm just going to do a few quick definitions. Number one being encoding, okay, which is the conversion of information into codes. So visual, what we see, laser pointer back on. Auditory is what we hear, and semantic is a posh word for changing information into meaning, giving something meaning. We're going to look at these mainly when we come to the Crick and Lockhart model, but they're just a few quick definitions for this moment in time. But storage, when we've stored something, it means we've retained the information. And I suppose the more common name for that, sorry, is learning. When you've learned something, it's been stored there for good. And retention means to store, to retain, to keep. And also we're going to use the word retrieval, how you recover the stored information. So we're going to use these two words in particular when we're talking about this model, the multi-store model developed by Atkinson and Shiffrin. And I'm going to mainly deal with the visual, auditory and semantic information when we talk about Crick and Lockhart. But let's first go to the multi-store model of memory developed by Atkinson and Shiffrin. So firstly then, why is it called a multi-store model? Well, Atkinson and Shiffrin say that we store information in three different memory locations, if you want to think of it like that. We've got a sensory store, or more technically called a short-term sensory store, or STSS. We've got a short-term memory, also known as STM, and a long-term memory, also known as LTM. Now, what they say is that we store information in all three, but they are all slightly different from each other, and we're going to look at that now. So let's begin with the STSS, the short-term sensory store. Now, as I've written down here, stimuli enters the brain. So this is your short-term sensory store, is your first memory bank. Everything you see, hear, touch, smell, taste, feel, detect, hits your short-term sensory store, all comes into your STSS. As a result, your STSS has a very large capacity. It can hold lots of pieces of information. The downside is you can only hold that information for up to 1 second. So at any one moment in time, right, even right now, you are being bombarded with stimuli and it's all hitting your short-term sensory store. What you've got to do with this large amount of information is filter it. You've got to decide right now what is the most important thing to focus on and what can I do to block out. And we call this process your selective attention. So selective attention takes place in your short-term sensory store. So a common sport example would be a penalty taker in football, or a rugby player taking a conversion, or a basketball taker, a player taking a free throw, for example. Lots of information is hitting their short-term sensory store. Noises and sights from the crowd, from teammates, from rivals, things like that. So lots of information is entering it. They've got to block all that out and focus on what they decide to be the most important thing, which is obviously making the shot or making the penalty or making the conversion. They focus on their technique. And so your selective attention, you focus on the important information and you block out the irrelevant. All the irrelevant stuff that you decide not to focus on is lost. And that's what this arrow represents here. You losing the information. Whatever you decide to pay attention to makes it through to your short-term memory. So lots of information coming in, but only one piece of information making it through into the next stage, which is your short-term memory. And that process there, that arrow there, is called your selective attention. Block out the irrelevant, focus on the most important thing. So that one thing you decide to focus on then makes it through to your short-term memory. Now, what can we say about the short-term memory? Well, this is the one that we use pretty much all the time, every day, okay? So it's known as the working memory. Decision-making, that should say, takes place, sorry, in here. It's just cropped it off a little bit. Apologies for that. So your short-term memory is your decision-maker. Based on the information that makes it through your short-term sensory store, your short-term memory decides, right, what should I do in this situation given that piece of information that I've just received? Now, your short-term memory can hold up to approximately 7 items of information. So, you know, classically in the exam, 5 to 9 pieces of information will get you the mark, and it can hold that information for about 30 seconds. Now, as we've said, only information sent through the STSS, the short-term sensory store, can make it through and reaches your short-term memory, and that is that selective attention process there, what we decide to focus on and what we decide to block out. Now, 30 seconds isn't a very long period of time, and you might be thinking, I can remember things for longer than 30 seconds. We can, of course we can. But this where this point comes in, to extend the length of the short-term memory, we've got to repeat the information. So when someone, for example, gives you their phone number and you're scrambling around looking for a pen, that's why you repeat it over and over to yourself to get it to last a little bit longer in your short-term memory. And using phone numbers as an example, we can also do a process called chunking, where you chunk information together. You think of how we remember a phone number. We don't remember it as single digits, 0741. We go 0741239, but we chunk information together. We've got more chance of remembering things if we chunk information together. How does that have a sport application? Set pieces. You will play sports where the set piece, and you give each set piece a name. You don't remember the set pieces, individual movements by individual players. You remember the entire set piece under a code name that you will shout when you want to play that set piece. So we can chunk information together to ease the storage of it and ease the retention of it. However, if we want to store something for good, if I want to store a piece of information or a movement pattern or a skill that I've learned for good, I've got to rehearse it. If I rehearse something, i.e., repeat something enough times, it gets passed into my long-term memory, where it gets encoded, a word that we came across on the first slide, i.e., it gets stored for good, and then it's retained. However, if I decide not to rehearse information, I'll lose it. And again, that's what this arrow pointing down is representing, the loss of information. So these arrows here, I can store things for 30 seconds in there. If I rehearse and rehearse and repeat, I can make it last a little bit longer. But if I practice things long term, I will transfer that knowledge into my long-term memory, where it's stored for good. Equally, you'll see there's a two-way arrow, which I'm going to talk about again in a second. When I want to get that information again from my long-term memory, my short-term memory can retrieve it from the long-term memory. Because remember, this is the memory that is decision maker. It decides what it wants to do based on the information received from your short-term sensory store. So finally, then, your long-term memory. So this has an unlimited capacity. You will never fill your long-term memory. Don't think I've got to forget, oh, my memory's full, I've got to forget things before I can learn new things. Load of rubbish, okay? And then also as well, really important, it can store information for long periods of time. Very often the answer is indefinitely. Once you've stored something in your long-term memory, very rare that you'll lose that information. You can learn to ride a bike, then not get on a bike for 20 years. When you get a bike after 20 years, you don't then put stabilizers back on, and you've got to relearn it. Once you know it, and it's stored there. So once something's in the long-term memory, it's there for good. Once we've encoded it, it means it's been stored with meaning, and we generally only store meaningful information in our long-term memory. The term that you might be familiar with using, skills or motor programs, are stored in your long-term memory. They're movement patterns. So for every skill that you can do, throwing, catching, kicking, running, jumping, in your sport and in life, it is stored as a motor program in your long-term memory. So not only do we store information, we store motor programs in our long-term memory, and that's really applicable to sports performers. Now, thinking back to your stages of learning, cognitive, you're a novice, you're a beginner, associative, you're an intermediate performer, autonomous, you're a top-level performer. Autonomous performers have very correct and very, refined motor programs stored in their long-term memory, hence why a lot of their sports actions look automatic, hence why they just do things and it looks right, and it very often is right. But the key thing here is your long-term memory only stores information. It doesn't really, it's your short-term memory that decides which information it wants. So if we bring all these three together in this diagram with a little sports example, let's talk through one now. So let's stick with a free throw in basketball. You've just been fouled and you go to the free throw line in basketball, right? So the crowd are making lots of noise, they're waving things behind, in your line of sight. All your players are lined up around the key, ready to go in and get the rebound. You've got to block all that out so you lose that information and just focus on putting the ball and making your free throw shot and making it into the hoop, okay? So that's the piece of information that goes into your short-term memory, the distance to the hoop, let's say. Your short-term memory decides, right, I need the motor program for the free throw, because that's the shot I need to execute in this situation. So it transfers that information to long-term memory and says, can I have the motor program for a free throw, please? Your long-term memory sends it back to your short-term memory, and then you execute the shot. Now, that's how Atkinson and Shiffrin say we deal with situations in sport and we deal with situations in life. We have three memory stores that interact with each other and pass information to and from each other. Hence why it's called the multi-store model of memory. So then on to Crick and Lockhart's model then. And Crick and Lockhart said, kind of an opposing view, and that's why I've put that there, opposes the view that we have separate memory stores. So they don't say you have a short-term sensory store and a short-term memory and a long-term memory. They say that what we do with the information is more important than how it is stored. Sorry, I keep moving my laser point off. How it is stored. And this dictates how long it's stored for. So in other words, the meaning of the information is more important than the repetition. So Atkinson and Shiffrin said, you, in order to get something from your short-term memory to your long-term memory, you had to rehearse, repeat, and that's what ultimately led to you encoding it or retaining it in your long-term memory. Whereas Crick and Lockhart say it's not actually down to that. It's not about the repetition. It's how much meaning you give to something. So I suppose an example of that will be, as has happened to all of us, I bet you've been told something or seen something and it blew your mind, like some kind of statistic or fact or something, and it stuck with you. And, you know, you didn't rehearse that thing that you saw or that you were told. You didn't repeat it, but it stuck with you. You heard it once and that was enough for it to stick, because at that moment in time, you gave a lot of thought to what you were being told or what you saw, and it stuck in your brain straight away. And that's kind of what Crick and Lockhart are saying. If something has more meaning, that makes it stick in your long-term memory more than the repetition side of it. And they came up with this model instead. And it shows that how much something is considered is referred to as the depth of processing. And the deeper it's processed, the longer the memory will be stored. So in other words, the more meaning you give to something and the deeper you think about it, the more it's going to be stored in your long-term memory, not the repetition, not repeat and rehearse. Like what Atkinson and Shiffrin said, how you take something from the short-term memory and then ultimately encode it or retain it in the long-term memory. And Crick and Lockhart put it down to three things. They said, for example, if you look at something, the structure of a word, that's quite shallow in terms of the depth of processing. Hence why us teachers, and me in particular, always get fed up when students just revise by reading. You're actually just looking at words, and therefore that's quite shallow processing. It's not going to stick in the memory for very long. Now, to get it a little deeper, to get a little more depth of processing involved, we can then go with phonetics, which is one of the reasons I started doing these videos in the first place. You can listen to my god-awful accent, try and explain these theories to you and things like that, and it might work, it might not. But if you listen to something, it allows you to get it a little bit deeper. There's more depth in terms of the processing, and you've got more chance of storing it in the long-term memory. But the crucial one is this one. If you can give something meaning, you can say why that's important or why you need to know that, or the impact on the performer is this. That's when you get the full depth of processing, and that's when you get the information to store in the long-term memory. So things are more likely to store in your long-term memory the deeper you process that information, and that's increased by giving something more meaning. So you could get asked questions about the Atkinson and Shiffrin model, the multi-store model, or you could get questions about Crick and Lockhart's level of processing model. I'd say either one, you know, 3, 4, 5 marks, something like that. There's more marks to be available on the Atkinson and Shiffrin because there's more things to talk about. Short-term sensory store, short-term memory, long-term memory. Whereas this is pretty much on this slide, everything that you can say about Crick and Lockhart's model. The only other question that can come up is, regardless of the model, how do we get to store more information in our long-term memory? And that's what I'm just going to look at on this last slide. So like I've just said there, these are strategies that will get you marks in the paper, but for either model, be it the Atkinson and Shiffrin model or the Crick and Lockhart model, you know, if you get asked a question about how do you maximize storage in the long-term memory, these are answers that will get you marks regardless of the model that the question might ask you about. So as we've got here, giving meaning to the information. Yes, that's mainly linked to Crick and Lockhart, but obviously, if you're following Atkinson and Shiffrin's model and you think that's how we store things, if you give something meaning, remember you'll be able to store it a little bit longer in the short-term memory. It will aid the retention in the long-term memory. Associating what you're currently learning with previously learned things, aka transfer skills. If you can make links between something you already know, that's going to benefit your current learning as well. Also, this keyword chunking. Okay, I'm going to make sure I underline that, chunking the information down into manageable pieces. Like I said, our phone numbers, you remember them as 071, you chunk it together in 3-digit blocks. And like I said, in sport, common way to do that is remember a set piece under a set name. That's a common example there. And then finally, where two separate marks. Mental rehearsal, so mentally picture what you've got to be learning. If it's a skill or a technique or a set piece, mentally picture it, mentally picture what you've got to do and what everyone else has got to do. But then combine that with physical practice, with actual physical rehearsal. That's going to make it stick in the long-term memory. So this video has been everything about the memory models and how we store information in your memory. Hope you found it useful, folks.